introduction. Dennis is the director of Ethnopharmacology at the Heffter Research Institute. Dennis is an elder from whom we can learn. He's got a new book, The Brotherhood of the Treatment of Death. Over the decades, he's contributed to our study an enormous compendium of solid research in the psychedelic area. What I'm going to talk about is ayahuasca from the historical perspective initially, and then the position we find ourselves in now. Ayahuasca is emerging on a global stage. Where is that taking us in the future? With this plant and this plant complex, I think that we're participants in a co-evolutionary process. And, the plant time frame and understanding of this is far different than ours. And I think that's probably one of the reasons about the cognitive dissonance that we have. Humanity is going through some, sort of rough periods in its relationship with ayahuasca. But it's not going to go away, and it will smooth out over time, we always have to remember what ayahuasca, never fails to remind me of whenever I take it, which is, you monkeys only think you're running things. The Heffter Research Institute, we're similar to MAP in that we support psychedelic research. We're not as well known or as public. We're not really a grassroots organization like MAP is, but we are in cahoots trying to change the nature of science, the nature of therapy, and ultimately some of the regulatory frameworks that we have to labor under. Those are necessary too if we're going to really make a difference. Ayahuasca is a psychedelic beverage that's used throughout the Amazon basin as really the linchpin of ethnomedicine or this tradition in Peru that they call vegetalismo. And it's unique among South American hallucinogens or hallucinogens anywhere in that it's made from at least two plants, always with two plants, one of which is a vine. And serapisplati, which is itself called ayahuasca, as well as a beverage, and various admixture plants, but most often Psychotria viridis is the most widely used admixture. And the Psychotria viridis contains dimethyltryptamine, which is the hallucinogen part. That's what gives ayahuasca its visionary kick, if you will. But DMT is inactivated in the body by enzymes in the gut and in the liver known as monoamine oxidases. Well, conveniently enough, the beta-carboline alkaloids in Banisteriopsis happen to be potent inhibitors of that enzyme, so they prevent the breakdown of DMT and allow it to be absorbed in an orally active form. And instead of the 10 or 15 minutes of absolute astonishment that follows when you smoke DMT, this is 4 to 6 hours of a much less intense, but in some ways much more noetic kind of experience, and that you can bring noetic content out of it. How long have we been in a relationship with ayahuasca? Well, nobody really knows based on archaeological evidence. There's wild speculation that it goes back at least 5,000 years. We'd like to think it does. We know that humanity in the Amazon basin has had relationships with snuff, for example, DMT-containing snuff, for at least that long. And it seems likely that the area where the snuff are used or were used, are still used, we know the snuff go back at least 5,000 or 6,000 years. And in that same area, Banisteriopsis grows, but it's not clear that it was used. The archaeologist Manolo Torres has suggested that there was a lot of chewing of Banisteriopsis that went on, or that it might have been used that way, and that if the people happened to be taking snuff at the same time, they quickly get the memo that these combinations were definitely reinforcing and synergistic. We don't really know. The only real indication of any archaeological evidence is this bowl and similar bowls. This is called the Quito bowl. Generically, these were called vasos de los brujos. They were decorated with stereomorphic figures, anthropomorphic figures, snakes and animal images. And it has been suggested by the archaeoethnologist Tupac Naranjo that these were vessels used to prepare ayahuasca or boil up other kinds of psychoactive ingredients. maybe so, but there's been no chemical analysis of the residues in these bowls. So that's really speculation as well. They probably go back to about 500 BC or 500 before the Christian era, somewhere between then and 500 after the Christian era. So no one knows, but it seems likely that ayahuasca has been around about that long, and nobody can really say beyond that. But when you come into the modern era, there are various ways to talk about the history of ayahuasca. You can do it chronologically, in which case we'd never get through this. We may never get through it anyway. But you can talk about it from different aspects that are important. You can discuss botany to begin with. Who first reported this? When did it come into the modern consciousness? And it did so in the 19th century. And the first person to document the use of an intoxicating beverage was this fellow here, Manuel Villavicencio. He was an Ecuadorian geographer, and he reported on the use of an intoxicating beverage among groups on the Napo. But he didn't publish this work. And the first, even though his report predated the report of Richard Spruce, who was an English botanist and explorer, gets the credit. Initially, he observed ayahuasca being used among the Guajibo tribe in 1851. And then later in 1858, he observed it being used among the Tucano and an Andean group, the Zaparo. Unlike the other explorers, Spruce had the presence of mind to collect specimens. I think it would be an obvious thing, but sometimes it just doesn't occur to these guys. So he collected specimens, and on the basis of those specimens, it was originally classified as Danisteria Poppy. The species name was Poppy, one of the indigenous names they were applying to it. And then that became revised in the 1930s in the revision of the family, the Montpellier, and it was renamed to Danisteria Poppy, which is the name that it now has. Spruce was the first to really report on ayahuasca and bring back specimens. In a sense, the other reports, the earlier reports, are kind of footnotes to history. It was left to Richard Evans Schulte, the famous Harvard ethnobotanist, who's probably the world's expert on ayahuasca, to eventually sort all this out, which he did in 1957, so quite a leap from the original discoveries. He published a very significant paper, which was completely ignored by most people. It was called The Identity of the Montpelliers Narcotics for South America. This was 20 years of the word narcotic. Any psychoactive substance was once characterized as a narcotic. Of course, they're not. But this was a very detailed paper in which he published what was known about the botany of ayahuasca at the time. And the question of admixture plants hadn't even entered the picture at this point. It was all about the ingredients of ayahuasca. And that paper, if you happen to have it, is a treasure trove. There's a lot of discussion of other species in the same family that don't really get into the usual conversations about the botany of ayahuasca. There's still a great deal to be sold out there. Other genera of the Montpelliere family are also used to prepare ayahuasca. They've been barely studied. Schulte gave the definitive state of the art of ayahuasca at the time. And then fast forward to 1967, the Summer of Love in San Francisco. Everyone was so busy celebrating the Summer of Love that almost no one noticed that there took place in San Francisco a landmark conference at that time. The Ethnopharmacology Search for Psychoactive Drugs was published by the Department of Health and Welfare at the time. Your tax dollars at work, one of the better uses of your tax dollars. It was a conference where all the luminaries in this area came together and tried to puzzle out what was going on, not only with ayahuasca, but all these other South American hallucinogens that were getting attention. Thanks to Earth and Fire, they have the entire volume of the Ethnopharmacologic Search on their website. You can download and look at it. It's very interesting from a historical point of view how little we knew that point, and this was 1967. It's really interesting to read some of the discussions after the presentations. Nobody had a clue how ayahuasca worked. There was no mention of admixtures at the time. There was psychosia, which is mentioned once in the entire book, because I am supposed to submit it offhand remark. One of my graduate students collected psychosia. Nothing was known of the chemistry at that time. It was only a couple years later, after Schulte's graduate student, Homer Pinkley and R. Vermargarosian collected the samples of Psychotria viridis and Diplocaris cabaremus. Both agnostic plants were used by the cofan. R. Vermargarosian was a chemist, and he isolated dimethyltryptamine, or detected dimethyltryptamine in both of these. And because they knew of this problem with the oral inactivity of DMT, and they knew that their carbolines were MAO inhibitors, that all sort of clarified the picture at that point. But there's much more to be learned about the botany of ayahuasca and the associated plants. In 1986, Eduardo Luna and I worked on what amounted to just a big literature search on other admixture plants to ayahuasca, which there's in the neighborhood of 100. We reviewed what was known at the time on about 52 of them, with reported uses either as additives to ayahuasca or used in the context of yetis. Of those 52 genera, about 23% of them are purported to be hallucinogens in their own right. In other words, they're sometimes used with ayahuasca and sometimes alone as psychoactive preparations. And very little is known on the chemistry of these things. So there's a couple PhDs there for anybody who's interested. There's probably a lifetime of work just sorting out this admixture plant technology, not to mention the pharmacology side of it and how that affects, how do these plants alter the pharmacology of ayahuasca? Why are they used? And, you know, there's a lot of work still to be done on this, very well characterized plant complex. Move from botany to chemistry, these things are complementary. We actually have to go a couple of decades earlier than the discovery or the recording of ayahuasca. We have to talk about the 1840s, 1841. These German chemists, Heinrich Goebel, and Johann Fritz, they were working on Pagan Carmelite, which is the Syrian rue, a completely unrelated plant to ayahuasca in a completely different part of the world. But they isolated carmeline at first, and then several years later they isolated harmine from the seeds. That's why these alkaloids have those names. They're named after Pagan Carmeline, not after ayahuasca. Again, 16 years later, people started making extracts of what was purported to be banisteriopsis. These people almost never had any botanical vaccine specimens. So for the first, couple of decades, all the work was basically a waste of time because they didn't have vaccine specimens. They isolated compounds, which they call various, like telepathine and yahanine and banisterine and so on. One of them even went so far as to assert that the source plant for their yahanine isolate was Prestonia amazonica, completely unrelated to ayahuasca in a different family. And again, undocumented by botanical vaccine specimens at all. Interestingly, that rumor, that misidentification essentially, persisted in the literature for years, decades, and eventually in the 60s. Schulte's had to step in and published a paper called Prestonia amazonica, Amazonian hallucinogen or not. Well, it turns out not. Mistakes can persist in science if you don't document your source plants, so this is something that kind of want to learn. Well, eventually, they did start working for vaccine material, and Lewis Lewin, who is famous for writing the book Fantastica, I'll work on it. Isolated banisterine, named it banisterine, and Merck chemist confirmed that that was harming. And so then in the 50s, Hochstein and Paradis did a much thorough analysis with better equipment and showed that there was harming, harmaline, and tetrahydroharmine and ayahuasca. And we now know that those are the three major alkaloids. Interestingly, Lewin gave Harmon to his friend Kurt Berenger. Both of these folks had worked on the peyote practice and said, you know, give it a try in some patients. So he tried it out on a group of 17 Parkinson's patients, and it showed remarkably positive effects in terms of controlling neurotrophic disorders. That was the first time that a non-antioxidant inhibitor had been applied to that. People were working on ayahuasca, and the chemistry of ayahuasca, DMT, was coming along on a parallel track. Originally, the Canadian chemist R.H.F. Mansky, who's well known for his 20-volume work on alkaloids, isolated a series of tryptamine derivatives, was working on the consistency of the strawberry strain. He isolated a series of tryptamines to use as chemical standards. One of them was DMT. It was unknown from nature at that time, and its psychoactive properties were unknown. He synthesized it, used it for his chromatographic work, put it on a shelf, and forgot about it. Then a Brazilian chemist came along a few years later and isolated a compound called nitrate from the mimosa acetyl, which is the source of urema, a psychoactive beverage used in eastern Brazil. He isolated a compound called nitrate, and that turned out much later it was shown that that was the same as DMT. In the late 50s, Fitz Johnson and Horning isolated DMT from Anandamantra peregrina called schizophrenia peregrina at the time, but now that name has been changed. Isolated DMT, speculated that that was probably the active principle, but were not able to, to develop it. That's where DMT was. And then eventually chemistry and pharmacology came together. And it came together in a totally unlikely way because William Burroughs, set out in 1950 to find ayahuasca. He was the first ayahuasca tourist. He was remarkably ahead of his time because he had an insight. He called it the final fix. And he was addicted to heroin, as supposed to be known. He thought ayahuasca might be a way for him to get off heroin. So he was kind of a pioneer in that way. In 1956, another pioneer, Hungarian chemist Stephen Zara, who was working at NIH at the time, decided to try DMT by injecting it into himself. And that was the first time that he discovered the uncontested psychoactive properties of DMT. It worked. And he wrote about this. And eventually, he became head of the National Institute on Drug Abuse, which I thought was kind of fitting. In 1961, Julius Axelrod, a neuropharmacologist, won a Nobel Prize later for his work on neurotransmission, isolated enzymes from rabbit lungs that would synthesize DMT from tryptophan in vitro in tissue homogenase. He demonstrated that DMT could be endogenously produced. And then about a decade later, he and Saavedra isolated DMT and some other derivatives from the human brain. And eventually, I ended up working for his protege, Saavedra. That's what attracted me to go work with him. As it turned out, we worked on some completely different things. Fun to work in that lab. Jeremy Bigwood, kind of an underground figure in the psychedelic world, a pioneer, was the first person to actually confirm that combinations of carmine and synthetic DMT were, in fact, orally active. But he never published this, and so he is a footnote. I wrote him recently, and he said, I'm fine being a footnote. I have no problem with that. I was working on my PhD thesis at that time, became my project to investigate the chemistry and pharmacology of ayahuasca. So my paper, monoaminoxidase inhibitors in South American hallucinogenic plants, was the first quantitative look at the MAO activity of ayahuasca and the constituents of some of these atmosphere plants. In 1993, we undertook a biomedical study at the invitation of the União do Vegetal, one of these syncretic Brazilian churches that used ayahuasca as a supplement. They invited myself and a number of investigators, notably Dr. Charles Rowe, who was the head of the project, to go in and do whatever we wanted. We carried out psychological profiles and biochemical measurements and so on. one unexpected finding that was interesting was that ayahuasca in drinkers, as opposed to people that didn't consume it, it persistently upregulated the serotonin transporters. What does this mean? There's a definite biochemical difference between drinkers and non-drinkers. We weren't sure, but then we looked at the literature, and it turns out that deficits in these transporters are linked to behavioral dysfunctions such as alcoholism, severe depression, depression with tendency to suicide, this kind of thing. So it appears that ayahuasca might actually reverse those conditions, because most of the people that we interviewed had been fairly dysfunctional when they had joined the church and ended up ayahuasca, and the supportive community got them straightened out. From 1990 to 2013 was the era where you might say ayahuasca went global, and is going global. This is the era we're in now. A trigger to this was Eduardo Luna's publication with Pablo Anaringo, the Peruvian painter of ayahuasca vision. This was really kind of the first mass marketed book about ayahuasca where people got a feeling of what's going on down there in Peru with these shamans. That was published in 1991. And from that time, there's been a slowly building phenomena of ayahuasca tourism. The epicenter of that is mostly the Amazonian river town of Iquitos. More and more people are coming to Iquitos to experience ayahuasca, and there's also itinerant ayahuascaros are now coming to the United States on a sort of rock star basis to do tours. There was a landmark conference on ayahuasca at the Cathedral Hotel in San Francisco in 2000. That was the first conference that I know of that was totally devoted to ayahuasca. And then Alan Shoemaker, who's an expat living in Iquitos, has been organizing the international conferences on shamanism for the last, I think he started in 2005. And that kept it going, and that elicited a lot more, you know, more interest. Whether that's good or bad, I'm not making a judgment here, but it has kept it, you know, sort of in the public spotlight. Another significant development that took place in the 2000s was the Supreme Court decision, the União de Vegetal, one of the Brazilian churches. The U.S. government was threatening to prosecute them for using their sacrament and importing it from Brazil, and they fought back. They actually sued the Department of Justice for the right to use ayahuasca under the Religious Freedom Restoration Act, and the new Supreme Court, just reconstituted under John Roberts, unanimously ruled in their favor. And a few years later, they had the right to do that. If you want to drink ayahuasca legally in this country, you have to join either the UDB or the Santa Dina, which is the other Brazilian branch, and they have secured permission to use ayahuasca in Oregon. They haven't gone all the way to the Supreme Court. And Roy Haber, the lawyer that was mentioned earlier, was really instrumental in making that happen. And I guess the government basically decided not to press it all the way to the Supreme Court. So there is a measure of protection for people that want to use ayahuasca in a religious context. If you want to use it outside that context for psychotherapy or other things in a more secular way, you're still not protected. So you need to be careful if you're doing this. That's all. Okay, so we come to the present. Talk about landmarks. I mean, this is a wonderful conference here, but in some ways, I think the map Psychedelic Science 2013 conference is going to be on, no pun intended, many people's map for a long time, because this was an important event. It was kind of a milestone in that it let us look at the state that psychedelic science has reached. Over 2,500 people attended this conference. There were dozens of scientific presentations, posters, workshops on all aspects of psychedelic research. And one of the three main tracks in this, there was clinical, interdisciplinary, and ayahuasca. In a way, it was elevated in status. It's a real object of study, I guess. And so psychedelic science is back. It's not something you have to whisper about. We can be respectable. You can even proclaim that you're a psychedelic researcher, and, you know, they won't call the cops. Well, they might, but careful who you're talking to, but psychedelic science is real. I was just totally impressed with the quality of the presentation. And you're finally able to leverage these tools for good, for understanding consciousness and for as medicines of the spirit. We have a lot more to learn, but that at last we could sort of claim legitimacy by referring to all this great work that's going on through maps, Heffter groups in the UK and elsewhere. This is being done. It's really encouraging to see. I think we have to remember we're part of this ongoing evolutionary process, this symbiosis. We're learning how to integrate this ancient medicine that's literally come out of the Amazon, one of the most threatened spots on the planet in terms of environmental and cultural collapse, to hopefully teach us some lessons to help wake the monkeys up, if you will. And I think over the next 20 years, we're going to see the fruits of this. I think you're going to see new therapeutic modalities for healing as that potentially have the potential to revolutionize psychiatry and medicine. We're also learning through our own personal experiences with ayahuasca. We're learning a new compassion for each other, a new respect for nature and indigenous wisdom and all life on Earth. And this is really the central lesson that we have to learn if we're going to make it through this bottleneck. We have to learn to, you know, love nature, love each other, and become protectors and stewards of nature rather than exploiters of nature. So hopefully ayahuasca is going to help us learn those things. Thank you.